enthusiastic in their very criticism, and I must say that I have written a piece before 3-4 months, Smart Cities in an Unsmart Country, which is also very critical of this whole idea and not getting a very clear roadmap to how things would happen. But I just want to mention, I'm playing devil's advocate here. We had a meeting before about a month in India International Center, and we were privileged to have Secretary, Ministry of Housing and Urban Poverty Alleviation chairing the session. And we thought that this is the right venue to vent our criticisms, and believe me, as the participants here shared that it is not going to be pro-poor, it will not address the basic necessities. Smart cities is a concept which is borrowed one, the private companies will come in, and you know, what she said is interesting. She answered every question. Okay, this is your criticism that the migrant laborer will not be taken in. Here is the document. You read that. So there are documents which answer all your queries. You say, oh, it's not going to be pro-poor. Come on, here is the clause. Somebody, a friend and colleague, Om Mathur, said, it really means that you're taking away the power from the local bodies, creating special purpose vehicle. You talked about decentralization, autonomy of the urban local government. Now what's happening? You're subjecting them to some parastatal agencies. He said, no, this is not true. Here is another document. So basically what I'm saying is that in terms of policy documents or the statements made by different dignitaries and ministers, everything is answered. But what actually is happening on the ground is very important. Here is a Bloomberg Foundation, I know that. They are sending questionnaires. Some institutions in India are replying to that, building up indicators, the kind of indicator that you talked about. We'll share about that indicator later on. And this has become a mechanical exercise. And I would like to know whether this vagueness that exists in defining the roadmap to smart cities, is it deliberate? Is it purposive? That you can talk about water supply, sewerage, sanitation, pro-poor in the context of slum when you're facing an election. But actually, the agencies which are being given the responsibility of operationalizing it, the private, I mean, I met at least, I was in Soviet Union, I was in Moscow, I was in Hangzhou in the last 3-4 weeks. And believe me, I met at least 3-4 people who are interested in being, who have been invited to become consultants. So they're coming to India to help the foreign companies in investing. So I think what is important is to see how things are getting operationalized and not to see what statements have been made. There are different statements which are there. There's no clear-cut operational map. And I met one, you know, consultant who is helping some Dutch company. He has never been to India. He's coming for the first time to tell how the city of Bangalore would get funding from different companies. I certainly therefore think that we have to be watchful to see that the vested interests which are very strongly operating in this smart cities business, it can be a pure commercial proposition. It can be that the marginalized sections do not get it. But at the moment, policy documents are there. They're all taking care of A, B, and C. So I think this is a very, very challenging responsibility for the researchers and administrators to be watchful and see how things are getting actually operationalized. And that's something which is a major responsibility that we have. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Kundu. I, as a chair, have only one sentence to speak, and I don't know how to admire your presentation just in one sentence. So I leave it there.
Thank you very much to the organizers for inviting me. I have spent most of my life studying rural areas, so I was feeling quite isolated in being in a group of people who have been spent their lives studying the urban phenomena. But thank you, Professor Atal, for beginning with rural studies in Vishamirpet. Yes, the 50s and the 60s were certainly a decade when we were concentrating, looking at rural change. There were also, excellent studies documenting rural change. For example, Oscar Lewis's study, a wonderful study at that time. Many other studies which very closely documented rural change. And now the wheels in some sense have come around because we now have some excellent studies, ethnographical studies, sociological studies, looking at the urban sociological phenomena. And the wheel has also turned a complete circle in the sense that we have our friend Deepankar Gupta saying there is no rural. Everything is urban. So one is now not only looking at the impact of the rural on the urban or the urban on the rural, was basically describing a reality which actually cannot be disentangled one from the other. And I, for one, I don't know whether that is the case. But I think the urban does have a distinct identity. It has a distinct identity. It certainly has a distinct identity when we look at the economic phenomena underlying urbanization, because urbanization reflects not only a growth in the concentration of population, but that concentration of population also reflects concentration of demand, concentration of economic activity, economic agglomeration, economies of scale in economic activity, which are considered to have, you know, many, many ramifications. So we do think that the urban phenomena is important. And of course, we think that the urban phenomena is important because another circle, you know, another the wheel has turned another full circle. In policy sphere, we now hear much more of the urban phenomena. The rural phenomena, despite the mass suicides and a lot of distress which we see around us in the country, it still is not attracting the same kind of attention in policy spheres. So that is another reason why we meet ever so often to discuss the urban and not the rural, not the farmers of this country and not others. You know, I think I not having been an urbanist and not really having dedicated a large number of years to study process of urbanization, I will be only able to deal in you know, of this whole thing in a number of very simple and a few simple propositions. The first is, you know, listening to the many presentations, excellent presentations that were made since the morning. When you want to, my own understanding is that when you want to look at cities or to understand their growth, this understanding has to be located in a number of distinct but interrelated issues. For example, the issue of demographic change and the economic influence which urbanization exercises. Number two, the technocratic or what you may call the expert views on urbanization, what needs to be done, what do the experts say about different things. The role of the state. The state has to deal with the externalities, it has to deal with the provision of public goods, hence it has to deal with the financing issues related to the provision of public goods and externalities in the whole process of urbanization. There is a very important issue of the whole political economy of the urbanization, the political economy of urban development. And this is not only with respect to who controls the processes of urbanization, but the many areas and the many facets of contestations which take place within urban areas and over urban policy, all of which significantly determine outcomes. There is a issue of social embeddedness. You can't replicate the same urban phenomena. When I was listening this morning, for example, to the excellent presentation by Alakshendra, can you actually transplant, you know, an urbanization process which has taken place somewhere else in the world, say in Los Angeles or wherever, to an urbanization process in Madhya Pradesh? And in what sense can you do it? So the social embeddedness of this urbanization process is, I think, very important. But not only does urbanization, you know, the processes of urbanization get determined by many of these things, they are also determined by the fact that urban development is located in the wider macroeconomic phenomena, the macroeconomic and social phenomena, and the wider political economy processes. So you can't really look only at the urban phenomena, the only what influences the urban phenomena, but the broad policy changes, the broad political economy of policy changes, and so on and so forth. So it's very difficult, for example, to locate the urban in the current context without looking at the shift in the macro policy towards neoliberalism from the 90s in India, to see how policies of regional growth, balanced development, which Professor Kundu talked about, were abandoned, then, you know, in some sense resurrected in the early years of this century, but in a very, very weak form. And then to basically, to understand, to see that how understanding of urbanization is so strongly embedded in the notion that urban areas are the primary locus of accumulation, and therefore the primary areas where you need to attract private capital, where you need to attract global capital. The kind of understanding, for example, which is was embedded in the 2009 World Development Report, Reshaping Economic Geography, which looked at urban growth and urban accumulation is that the key to economic growing economic agglomeration and growth in economic agglomerations is a key to growth in India. So basically, then there are obviously the policy implications of that is that the reverse of what Professor Kundu tried to argue, that you don't really need to look at balanced development. You don't need to look at Bihar will take care of itself if actually the growth centers around the country are, as long as you are able to push, give them a strong enough push. So that is something which is thing. But basically, one can see two things. One, first, for example, one can see what has been the outcomes of some of this, the kind of growth processes that we have seen. And I think this is something widely recognized. There is, and some of this, again, Professor Kundu has pointed to, there has been a growing rural-urban gap. There has been a growing concentration of growth within urban areas, within the kind of hierarchy of urban areas that we have. You have the larger urban agglomerations capturing most of this growth. And the urban agglomerations, of course, there's an overlay of urban agglomerations and economic agglomerations. They're not one and the same thing. Economic agglomerations follow what has been described as the hub and spokes pattern. So the urban agglomerations really are the hub. But the spokes also are very important parts of this economic agglomeration which are taking place. You have the complete, and this is very important, the changing morphology of urban agglomerations. Urban the morphology itself is changing very important, is very very significantly. And this is leading to new patterns of spatial segmentation and inequalities, and which have to, so the urban now has to be seen in a much larger spatial frame, in a much larger rural-urban spatial frame, if you like, than we were used to seeing, the patterns of spatial segmentation and segregation and so on, a couple of decades ago or so on. So these are very important implications. A lot of recent analysis of the urban processes has gone into looking at some of these issues. And what the core of both past policies and present policies, and here, of course, Prasanna is next to me, my very, very old class fellows. But, the point is policies always aim at what is feasible, particularly when you are in a particular context. So they have to be seen in this light. But at the same time, I think one needs to recognize that present policies, and here I'm talking about policies in the last 1.5 years, since this present government has come into existence, policies which have crystallized in as late as June of this year, really have to be seen as an acceleration of the trend that we saw in the earlier government. So now you do have a set of policies. You have the Atal Bihari Awas Yojana and of course the modified draft housing policy, and the nuanced difference between the earlier the 2007 housing policies to the modifications that have now been introduced. You have Amrut, you have the smart city concept, and I mean the National Urban Livelihood Mission is really a very minor component. So these three major components, and you can see very clearly what has happened if you look at these policies and analyze them separately. And this is my very simplistic reading of the policy shift that has taken place. Number one, you see a downgrading of the role of representative institutions, participatory institutions, in the shift that has taken place. Not that the earlier policies were in any sense, centered on participation, but you see a very clear shift. You see the increasing role, distinctly increased role of markets and PPPs within each of this, because you can see that public financing plays a much, much smaller role, and markets and PPPs play a much smaller role, a much larger role. You see an even greater focus on the larger cities, basically 13% of the old population, or less than half the, just about maybe about 35 to 40% of the urban population. You see a very clear correlation, positive correlation with administrative and fiscal capacity. The kind of policy, so basically much greater stress on fiscal capacity and administrative capacity being able to deliver goods. So if you're not strong in fiscal capacity and administrative capacity, boy, you've had it. You know, see, in other words, the betting on the strong. Betting on the strong in terms of size, betting on the strong in terms of capacity, betting on the strong in terms of fiscal capacity, that is much stronger now. So the net result of all this has to be a greater regional intercity divergence, a greater intercity divergence, and a greater polarization within cities. This, I think, is a very, very clear outcome of the latest change of policies. But one of the issues I think one needs to flag, and I want to just flag two issues very, very quickly. One is that even the policies that have actually, the unfortunate part is that the policies which have been laid out, in my view, are flawed. They're internally inconsistent. If you look at, for example, smart cities, they start with the concept, if you build cities, you invite growth. There's a correlation. So first of all, this correlation itself is faulty. There is a whole problem of endogenization. There's a whole problem of this, but the fact that at this present juncture, the people whom you require to build cities are in the greatest financial crisis. They find themselves in the greatest financial crisis in probably the histories, the real estate developers, the others, and to expect at this point of time these people to come in with significant, or others, the foreign capital to come in significant measure when the real estate developers and real estate capital within the country is reeling under in a crisis is, I think, wishing the moon. So I think internally there are a lot of internal consistencies in policies. I just want to make one last point and close, which is basically the factors that I pointed out initially, that urbanization has to be seen as a joint outcome of a number of factors. Now here, very often we stress one or the other. We stress one or the other while actually either talking about urban policies or critiquing urban policies. And frankly, neither critiques nor urban policies can be based only on discussing one component, either just a technocratic view or a political economy view or just a more sort of state-centric view of urbanization. It has to take into account all of these policies in order that, you know, we have different outcomes. What Amitabh Kundu described in an earlier session, inclusive urbanization, or more generally, because inclusive urbanization is a subset of inclusive growth and inclusive development. Let me stop.
Thank you, Professor Srivastava. You have made many important points, and I think the central point is that there is a need to understand the urban process in the context of changing social and political environment. Now, may I, Professor Sharma?
Like Ravi Srivastava, I have also been studying earlier only rural. Have just started a couple of years back some study on urban India also. This also came, Professor Atal, from my village studies, this interest. I was studying along with Jerry Rogers 12 villages in Bihar. For the last 30 years, three times we have gone. And now at the moment, on average I'm saying, some villages are nearer to town, some villages are distant. Only on average, 26% of the rural incomes comes from agriculture and allied activities, including agriculture labor. In Bihar, where there is 89% rural population lives. Of course, for India as a whole also, in rural areas, in rural India, dominant source of income is not agriculture, but non-agriculture. So you can understand now the linkage between rural India and urban India. So that's point on, and Ravi also talked about this. So I think this linkage, and there was sometimes back a study by World Bank which showed that urbanization in India is a major factor through labor markets and all that, which has reduced poverty. And the recent developments in India also shows that, you see, there has been negative growth of employment during 2004-05 and 2011-12 in rural India. All employment were created in urban India. For the first time, agricultural employment declined in the history of India. Absolute decline. So I think urban development and links of rural India with urban India, by the way, the recent census has also shown that commutation in India has increased. And it will increase more also because, you know, expansion of transport facilities, infrastructure, education. For the first time after last NDA government, transport infrastructure were given importance, which continued even now. So India is going to this, all this construction boom and all that, this is largely because of not only housing, largely because of road construction and all that. So it is going to competition. So I think understanding the current transformation, this rural-urban linkage is very important. And the other factor from, you can imagine, our urban definition is 5,000 plus population. There are also 75% non-agricultural population and all that. As a whole urban, already 24% of rural population in India lives in those villages whose population is more than 5,000. So on the basis of population, these villages will become urban. So as maybe next town, due to census activism, Amitabh, these villages will become urban. I have been arguing with Amitabh.